things to learn are present here. In 21st century, knowledge and creativity are the keys to success. As Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam said, excellence is a continuous process and not an accident. We, the students and faculty members of civil department, are privileged to welcome Dr. V. Balakumar as our chief guest lecturer. Dr. V. Balakumar got graduated from IIT Madras, Chennai in civil engineering after obtaining his degree in physics from Madras University. He took his MSc engineering degree from College of Engineering, Delhi. He took his PhD from the present Anna University, Chennai for his thesis, experimental studies of modern pipe raft on sand and field study of prototype behavior. In 1987, he started his own practice as structural and geotechnical consultant. One of the multi-storied structure, Palace Regency, designed by him, was supported on pipe raft. Presently, he is the whole-time retainer, consultant for MS Simplex Infrastructure Limited at Chennai office. He heads the research and design division. He has published more than 25 papers in national and international conferences and 2 journal papers. 2 of his papers have won national awards. Sir, welcome you, sir.
See, generally, you know, as a person who has been working in the field and fighting with clients, fighting with the consultants organization and so on, it gives me a lot of refreshing experience when I come to the students, right? And, basically the thing what I wanted to do today was, you have completed your foundation in your course in your 5th semester. 3-4 semester. Okay. Now, in principle, when you come to the career these days, whenever we try to look at our select a person, we always ask for a geotechnical experience. This has become a sort of a requirement irrespective of the organizations. Main reason is many of the constructions today, what you are now seeing as an infrastructure, you know, they have got weak basements, multiple basements, and deep excavations and things like that from road. Problem is, cost of your foundation structure is hardly around 20% of the total project cost. But the influence it has got on the time delay, it is phenomenal. And you can rectify a column or a beam if it cracks. But if an excavation fails, it is very, very difficult to rectify. And also, redo the entire foundation system is hell of a job. Right? Probably today I may not be able to really take up such cases because the whole thing is just 1 hour time, 1.5 hours, something like that. Okay. To bring in everything is very, very difficult. So now what I'm trying to show you, present to you today, it is mostly on the foundation, that is pile foundation, just a small restricted portion. Right? And in that restricted portion, it is only going to be a brief introduction of what we do in the design office and what we do at this end, right? So this is all what we are going to do today. But please remember, today in Pile Foundation, the developments are too much. Day by day, the subject is changing. And with all your present numerical setups, improvements in finite element analysis, mathematical programs, and your softwares, and so on and so forth, that has taken the subject to a very long way. What you are studying in your class, CNC plus gamma D of N Q plus R D gamma N gamma, it is only to give you an introduction, nothing more than that. But what we do in design office is far something far beyond that level. Like we do a three-dimensional analysis, detailed programming program, and then stress distributions, so on and so forth. Every problem is treated as a three-dimensional problem. An analysis is done only like that. Now, this is a brief introduction as like what somewhere you have to start the whole thing. See, most of the infrastructures as what we see today, it is going to be either tall, very heavy structures, or it is going to be transportation structures. Now, tall, heavy structures which are now used for your office complex, residential, now you see 30-story apartment, 30-story apartment buildings, 40-story apartment buildings like that, with multiple basements for car park, podiums, and so on and so forth. Right? When you get into a situation like this, you do the analysis fair enough. You have stack row, retypes, scrap, any number of programs to computer structural analysis. But when you are designing a retaining wall for the basement, what do you do? So this is where the problem begins. Why people now demand a students or trainees with geotechnical engineering background? It is mainly this is the reason. Because geotechnical engineering is one area where in the office alone you cannot work. You have to work in the field also. The data has to be provided for you to work with. To get a good data, that itself is a problem. So that is why now the demand on geotechnical engineering people are soon with geotechnical background is on the increase. When I passed out my master's in 72, people asked me a question. This was the question that was asked to me at that time. But step by step, as the subject grows, we also grow along with that. And then we reach a level now, we have become indispensable, practically for all practical purposes. Right? That is why organizations like Simplex and all, they are retaining us. We have no retirement. Unless we decide to retire and get out, which we will not. Because association with the subject is so thick, it's very difficult to separate people like us from soil mechanics. It's not possible. It has become like that. So obviously, it has got an extensive career growth. And so it's something like, you know, there is a, I don't know how many of you are Shirdi Sai Baba's devotees. Anybody is here? Who are devoted to Shirdi Sai Baba? If you see the photograph, there is like, you come one step forward towards me, I'll give 10 steps to you. Soil mechanics is exactly like that. You go closer to the subject closes and embraces you, and it will not leave you, and it feeds you. Very simple as that. Okay, this is what I have experienced in my life. I had been a structural designer, I had been a geotechnical engineer, and I had been a project manager. And many of my friends also agree with me when I am trying to express my opinion. So it is only on that score I took this topic. Give you a brief introduction, see how the things work today. And then thereafter, how you proceed further. If you want to work into that, then yes, we will see a different perspective of it. Okay? Now, if you see here, what is a project, how do you define a project? See, it is nothing but a facility which is created for a specific purpose. Maybe an academic institution which goes for teaching. If you are hospitality, that's to say there are certain specific terms these days they use in management science. Hospitality structures, study hotels, a simple language. Health projects, hospitals, commercial ventures. You go for transportation structures. If you take all these things together, everywhere structures are there. Highly specialized structures are there, but foundation engineering, when you come to the geotechnical expertise, there is only geotechnical expertise. There is no geotechnical expertise for a bridges or for any other specific structures. They don't specify. The main reason is the understanding of foundation design includes an understanding of the structural design also. Unless you understand structural design, you cannot understand foundation design, because how the load is transferred to the foundation, that's very, very important. Okay? So a good geotechnical engineer and a foundation engineer has to be a reasonably successful structural designer. I'm sorry. This is my granddaughter's voice which I think she is in US. Okay. That in mind, everything in soil mechanics and foundation engineering I cannot bring it to one. But not for that matter, nobody can bring it in 1.5 hours. So I have taken a small element of my foundation. And then we say go. My area of specialization is also pipe foundation. And then I worked on ground improvement techniques. And mostly fire element analysis and soil structural expansion. That is my area of specialization. Okay. All these things put together come into soil structural interaction, only one thing. And I don't stretch myself beyond that. Okay? Right. Now, if you see here, when you go for the subsection line, the basic requirement, what you try to have is a good knowledge of the requirements of the facility. That is the first part of it. Now, what is the significance behind it? Now, you are doing a hospital. Okay, let us put it that way. It's a multi-speciality hospital, which has got various types of blocks. And then you are either a project manager or a structural designer, whatever, in whatever capacity you are. Okay, now, if you look at it, you must know what a hospital means. What are the needs of a hospital? What are the facilities in the structure? Right? An architect gives you a plan, he gives a layout plan. Now, where to put the beam and where you should put the cart, there are certain specific requirements. You cannot have a cross beam in the north, in the operation theater. But shadows will come. Right? And if you have got a radiography block, it has got a very heavy equipment, X-ray machines are very heavy. Whatever you say, computerized, non-computerized, whatever you call it, scanning equipments, where to place them. What are the requirements? Right. Now, how do you design a foundation system? Say, suppose you put a raft. Let us forget about time for a minute. You put a raft. What is the basement drainage? You see, when you are going to have cancer specialty, what happens to them? See, they always put a mark here, right marks. Right? Where the, your cadmium needle is pushed inside for the radiographic treatment. The patient looks ugly with the time. Now, you put him in the main corridor bottle up. All incoming patients will get scared. So where to put what and how to do it, this is very important. And radiography room, it has to satisfy various specifications. Baba Atomic Research Center. So we have about 700 amount of RC wall surrounding the room where you said the radiography treatment is going to monitor the course. So how to, where to put it? You can put it in fourth floor. How do you design the RC wall floor? So it has to go to the basement. So like this, where what is very, very important. Same thing in plant and machinery when you are designing. You've got a highly vibrating instrument, so how to place it, how to connect it. So like this, when you are doing a structural design, even then, you should know what it is going to perform. A hotel, if you are designing a hotel, then what happens? Now you have stores, right? Stores, 5-star hotels or star, 7-star, such type of hotels, there are varieties of stores. Perishable item, non-perishable item, dairy products, meat products, seafood, seafood are highly perishable, next day peanuts, consumer. So like this, different types of store arrangement has to be provided. And they all needed drainage. So when you are designing your app, how do you take the drainage request? And how does it affect the foundation structure? How these things become very important. So that is what we say that we need the knowledge and the requirements of facility. Then the rest of the things are same. See, plot on, right? And static and dynamic loading, permissible throttle and differential settlement, and nature of equipment and equipment loading for the dynamic loads. All these things are required for you to design the system, and even when it comes to the question of a foundation design. Supposing you have a forge hammer inside a plot, your foundry, when you are going to have, you have the ladder, you know what is a ladder, where the metal is there. Right? And there is a furnace block in the electrical components. So many things are there for which separate structural arrangement is required. When you have a furnace block, you cannot have a beam in it again. All the wires have to go freely inside on top. So how do you decide? A 16 meter by 16 meter box structure. It has got an RC wall, it has got a roof stair, all this. The metal will come and down. Furnace will be poured from inside, furnace will be operated at the bottom. So, like this, there are varieties of structures which require the knowledge of the structure to which it is being put into use. Let us go for a transportation structure, embankments. High level embankments are going to be there when the railway passes on top. And it has to connect to the highway. So, how do you put the retaining wall? How do you design the embankment? You cannot have 14 meter wide embankment because it is going to encroach into agricultural properties. So your width has to be restricted. Then how do you reinforce the embankment? That is the reinforcement we have to consider the concept. Okay, with all of these things put together, when you come to the foundation design, all these aspects come into force. Right? So unless you understand the structure and structural behavior, foundation design becomes very difficult. Right? Let us go. The first step when you start designing a foundation foundation behind Mrs. Ayala Institute. Now, before that, I would like to give you a small episode which I had just 4 days before. See, as a contractor's consultant, we are doing a elevated corridor for the phase one expansion from Tiruvati to the Coimbatore. Okay? Even for the design, I'm supposed to be the coordinator for the designs, and I'm supposed to interact with the consultant as well as the client. Fine. And client consultant is a French consultant, it's problem. Yeah, they are experts in structural designers, particularly an elevated corridor is produced in the type of complicated phenomena. Now, what they are putting up, it's a highly complicated structure, the U girder, U-shaped girder, in which the train will go, the train will be traveling between the U. This is the arrangement. Okay? It is supported by the beam. The problem came out when they released the drawing. About the structural drawing, they were able to discuss very freely. When it came to the question of pile foundation, when I started trying to present certain aspect difficulties and modifications, the man who was talking so high about structures and the structures, so high-tech language which he was using, and conceptually was very good. When it came to the question of foundation, only one line of reply, we have to consult the majority of the country. He was not able to sit across in the discourse. So he has to go to his job to the paper. Which means, obviously, even an expert structural designer these days hesitates to work on foundation design. Okay? Particularly by foundations. So they feel so uncomfortable to discuss. So they want their beautiful to design as expertise at that time. So this is the question of importance of geotechnical engineering, particularly these days. It was not there about 30 years before. Today it has increased, and everywhere the structural designer plus the geotechnical engineer form the core team in the design step. That is exactly how it goes. So the first step is on solving a situation when you come into that. You have the selection of, see, first of all, planning a soil investigation itself is an art. Right? Depending on the nature of structures, what type of loading what you are going to get, for designing such a situation, what are the properties that are required to get, everything comes into the your testing procedure and selection of your building methods, like what are the field and laboratory tests that are involved, and the report preparation and review of report. These are the essential features that are coming into the design office. Then you go to the accepting agency. Then submit them the design parameters, get it approved by them, and then the design and monitoring comes into the picture. Particularly the information and ground improvement, monitoring becomes very, very important. Okay? Now, these things which you must have read in your soil mechanics portion, the type of tests that are being done, like standard penetration test, wave shear test, dynamic bone penetration test, static bone penetration, and then pressure meter, and there is something more of ours there, brass bolt sonic tests, and the question of block vibration tests, and so on and so forth. There are varieties of things are available today, and then we start our working to get the exact properties of the subsoil on which the structure is going to stand. Right? Now, this is what we try to do in the static penetration. See, the problem is this test was developed in late 1930s. Okay? Today is 2017. Even then, most of the design's parameter evaluation is based on this. Okay? So question is, the refinement in this is question of trying to calibrate the energy that is transferred, and based on the energy that is transferred, the so-called Ken value or the standard penetration test values are altered, and that is used for the design. The main problem is, why such things do take place is like this. When you are doing something in the lab, when you are doing something with your analysis and computer, when you go to the practical field and then try to cross-verify or validate the field results, you get a very wide variation in the results. So the question which makes that, neither one of them need a refinement. So that refinement takes place, which form part of the research in geotechnical design. Next. Okay, this is a simple sample which we try to do, which we use normally in the site to get the standard penetration. Next. So these are all the way the sample we try to look at it. But basically what happens is, see, that's what I said. When I talk on pile foundation, there are so many things that are there inside. Each one, it takes about 2 to 3 hours if I have to give you a lecture. Say particularly rocks are different ways. While passing through compressible layers. whilst deriving its capacity inside sand. Right? Large compressible layer getting sand pitched in between dense sand layers. Like this, there are varieties of situations are there where the procedure is not unique. Right? See, in a structural design module, you do your E-types at the start work, get your bending moment, shear force with the reinforcement. And you have only one elastic module, that is expertise. Whereas with reference to sand profile is concerned, it is not one module. There are six modules, elastic modules, tangent modules, secant modules, most pain value, highest pain value, stress control value, so on and so forth. So when I design a foundation system, as of today's requirement, the complications are quite many and request lot of not only the scientific background but also a good judgment on the assessment of properties. Right? So these are the things which, see, I am not trying to elevate my status of my subject because it's already elevated. I am a small fry in the group. But when you are youngsters, you are in college, when tomorrow when you are coming to an interview for an infrastructure project at the site, when somebody asks such type of topics, then you should not be in trouble. Right? Particularly if it involves a diaphragm, let us say, diaphragm wall, now when you are trying to see the detail, how to check that detail. It is not the number of bars and then the orientation of bars. It is with reference to the pressure distribution on the diaphragm. Now how do you check it in the field? You are expected to check it in the field itself. You can't send it to the office and ask office people to check it. That is not allowed in the present circumstances. In fact, that is what as a telemetro I am doing. As a designer, I am attached to the site, not to the design office. Very small extent I use my office. But then everything has to be taken a decision at the site level. And then you have to start collecting it, get it approved there, and then go forward. This is what is present day expectation in any projects. Right? Yes. So these are the various ways that we take the sample and start inspecting it, and then write a document with reference to the report. Next. This is a soil profile which we get. And there are certain populations like this that are available in standard textbooks and tubes. Right? Now please remember, these correlations are site-specific. But every site, these correlations can vary by 15% or 20% or 25%, whatever form it is, depending on the nature of the state and things like that. So these correlations have to be revalidated at the present site in which you are going to work. So which again, see, and understand one thing, right? Foundation engineering and then construction of a foundation really relative to 40-45% of your total time frame. And unless you are accurate, and then I'm talking of complicated, I mean high-level problems, not a bungalow or others. Even there also you get into a problem. If the soil is expensive or a swelling clay, you put up a bungalow in the 6 months when they occupy, it develops cracks. And then you are problem. You have to jump and you have a problem crack that. That question comes up. Right? So whether thing is big or small, that's why you always have your structural design two limits. One is what is called a serviceability limit, the other is called a limit, ultimate limit. Serviceability limit is defined by the performance requirement of the structure. Now you take a tank form, bar, petroleum tanks, what you see that when you go to conduct it and that goes like this. But those large tanks are not out of pipelines. If you see from the serviceability requirement of those tanks, the permissible settlement is a lot of 12 mm. Imagine a 43 meter, 50 meter diameter tank, which is 25 meter, 27 meter tank. The permissible settlement is only 12 mm. How do you design a system for it? And it should be economical at the same time. Right? So, which means the question, as much as the tank design is complicated, the tank foundation design is also equally complicated. You need a lot of three-dimensional analysis, idealization, and so on and so forth. That probably, if I get another chance to meet you, okay? At that time, then we can discuss about how do you try to do your software, using a software and a three-dimensional analysis for such foundation systems. How do you get the properties? How do you model the soil? How do you model the structures? How do you apply the loading and so on and so forth? Now, for the time being, I'll try to restrict myself with references. Now these are static and electrometer separators which are normally used in the site. The one at the end, the first one, it is 25 and a electrometer. piezoform. Piezoform, what it does is when you try to check the clay, it develops the pore pressure also, which helps me to compute the time that it takes for consolidation so that the negative skin friction and the pilot should above the term negative skin friction. Can I also look like that? Have you heard the term negative skin friction when you are in a pilot class? So those are the things which we can evaluate with reference to spherical penetrometer, and we use this test to be done in design by the Leica data, so that I get the shear strength profile from where I get the consistency and also the elastic modulus which I can use in the design process. So varieties of ways of representation show. From the bone penetration test, there are various methods of calculating the pilot capacities. Now, why we do all these things is, please remember, when you are going through the laboratory testing of the soil mass, you have to take an undisturbed sample in a tube, transport it to the lab, then extrude the sample from the tube, and then prepare it for putting it in a dry axial machine. By the time so much of disturbance takes place, it may not represent the true pilot. So we do a lot of in-situ tests, the bone penetration tests and other things, try to correlate it and then use them in the design process. So that validation is required, whether the property which tomorrow's imagery, this is our better one. When I am using a software, computer doesn't understand sand or clay. It depends only based on the elastic modulus, cohesion and angular fin down inflection and Poisson's ratio, and so on. It doesn't understand anything more than that. So your question of identifying it to the computer itself is very, very important to get the correct results. Otherwise, it's a garbage in and garbage out. Right? So that is why we do all these kinds of tests, particularly the larger projects where the settlement is going to require the design and things like that. We get all these difficulties. So we do all sorts of field tests and the laboratory tests to correlate and then try to derive the parameters and then try to use it in the design. Then next. See, if you see here, there are varieties of procedures that are given. Now, when it is given in this like this, it depends on the type of a condition in which you are going to work. See, for example, the first one. If the top soil is totally soft and it doesn't generate anything, we take effectively the four types of diameter as the influence diameter for the pile capacity, the area where the pile develops its capacity inside the founding layer. Now, if you get a moderately six layer above and below, then 80/60 below BP. So these are the various steps which are used, which you can use effectively only when you understand the soil conditions of the site based on the investigation report and then the type of testing what we have done and your exposure on the subject. These are all the very important essential features. Then you try to select the right procedure for your derivative so that your prediction is reasonably. Right? Next. So, first one. We have a data, various ways of data interpretation. There is a direct approach and an indirect approach where the question of validation comes into the picture, where connections are involved, and then try to use all these things and then try to get the file capacity. Maybe the variation is about 15% or 20%, but remember when I am doing a foreign plan that 4 tanks, 6 tanks, 12 tanks. See, the project normally when it comes in the beginning, you have it's a very huge involvement, say like 6,000 piles, 7,000 piles in it. So even if it space, say 1 meter in the pile, it amounts to the question of saving of 7,000 meters, particularly large diameter, 750 mm, 900 mm, like that. The money that is served is phenomenal. Right? And remember, your serviceability requirement of the structure depends on the behavior of the foundation. If the foundation shows differences, things will happen. And if you are working on a power project, if you are TG foundation settles down, that is the end of it. For months together, your TG will not work. So like this, there are a lot of limitations. So in principle, the serviceability limit or serviceability requirement of a structure is satisfied by the behavior of the foundation. Please remember that. So that is why foundation engineering has gained such a big importance, because based on economic requirements of the structure, they want to make it as slender as possible, and at the same time, it should behave properly. So this is exactly how the foundation design has gained such an importance now that unless you have a reasonably good background in foundation design, your structural design alone is not going to help you in your life. Okay, particularly in a larger organization when you need more. Believe me, an organization like L&D, they have a program of BAT every year on the foundation design. Main reason is the updating of the subject is such a person who is very routine in working more, he cannot get into it. So they need a people to come and guide them. So that is the specialty of geotechnical engineering. Okay? So now, yes. So now the question of we have to review the report and then try to target the parameters, whether it is truly representative or not, what I call the validation that has to be done. And say for example, when you have isolated footings that is recommended, it must give both safeguarding capacity as well as permissible support. Both the things should be there in the report. If it is not there, then the report will be anonymous. Now, if you are going to, for example, compressible play area, the results of consolidation plus time-based settlement work, everything should be there in the report. Then only you start using it and computing the pipe capacities, taking the play behavior into account and so on. So if the report is not reviewed properly, your design will not be proper and you will not be able to convince the client on what you are trying to do. This is what is going to happen now. So now if you see the design, you have a play. What's the time there? Another half an hour, we can. Is it okay for you? Are you having time?
Yes.
You can go for another half an hour? Sure. Right. Now if you see that the procedure when you are designing a pipe, if you have a gray layer and a sand layer, it is there before. It is not the same. Properties are different. Okay, next. So now you go for the computing the pipe capacities, then you question the layer. See, normally in a classroom, they always say that pipe is a friction pipe, bearing pipe, and so on and so forth. But there is nothing called a pure friction pipe and a pure bearing pipe. It is inward way. So you have to assess the properties and parameters, and then only you start designing. So we have different types of format. Now what is your next class type? Classes then?
No
class. No class. Right. Now if you see the stack for activity classes are there in this domain. So I will capture everything and then go over. There we have a detailed program afterwards. If time permits. Provided if you are all free. I will be free, but now you should be free. That is very important. Okay, now you have what is called a static formula and a dynamic formula. See, this dynamic formula normally can be used when we are driving the pipe. Right? Now we will go into the equipment circuit, then I will be able to get it further. So you have different types of energy that is transferred in the pipe. I don't know when you have done the pipe design, you have heard the Heine's formula.
What?
Heine's formula. WH divided by S plus C by U. You have heard the expression? Flows clean and unicorrectly. Yamo Nidhiya. Le Martha Sachi. Kala Samishka to Bukla. VMS Bukla to Bukla Pachana Pudgiliya. Adana Bukla Foundation Design. What is the book that was presented for you? In for Foundation Design. You know that this is not becoming a pure college in MBA category. I get into this problem whenever I wrote it. When I look back a question there, I was staying good. So interview if you are like that, then you will be in trouble. You will have, see, four years, you see, you will put in your biodata, 4 years experience, 5 years experience, you will put it. And I see some of the profile which is computer, SkyPro, E-Tab, so all the program it is written there. You ask them, how do you try to bring in the wind load in the SkyPro, how do you model the wind load? Sir, we have not done it that much. How do you give the, supposing if one beam sits on another beam, how do you change the boundary condition? So, if you complicated, I will tell you, sir. This is something which I have been facing in my day to day life. Whenever I interview the people, the guy is an M-Tech, and I ask them such a question. Very preliminary question, it's very difficult to get an answer from them. So many clues are used to give. You know what happens when the beam sits on another beam? There is no fixity. Then what you do? You will give it a hinge, sir. If you give it as a hinge, then one will become a cantilever, the other will become supported. Then what you will do? Yes. Same thing. To get one answer, that
that you will have to redefine the support or what I call the member release. You will have to give, to get that particular verb, I will have to give 5 different questions. Right? Eat apps. So how do you automate share value making? So, like this. See, these are the way people will put you in questions when you say you are not experienced and if you have got a computer exposure. Right? Never ever think that the man sitting on the other side, particularly if you are a person like me, say, don't think that they will not have a computer knowledge. It happens. And over your IIT candidate, you will answer from paper. Sir, computer will allow me, sir. The computer will enable me, sir. Please, sir. Program use for your end program. This is the question. We have used ADAPT because he had put a post tension slab on. He said ADAPT. Okay, you said that you have done a skew bridge. How did you bring the skew to the ADAPT? No. Like what my guide said, I did. I so, what do I do with a situation like that? How much I can train a candidate? Okay. So, that is the reason why we always insist, at least I insist, that when you are in the classroom, make sure that you learn maximum possible. It is not what your guide says, it is what you think that is very important. Okay? Right. Now, see there are varieties of energy that is there in your mouth. And see what happens if you really look at it. The pile generates its capacity when it is given, it is like this. When the hammer is lifted, that large amount of potential energy is stored in. When it comes and hits the pile, the potential energy stored in that gets converted into kinetic energy. And it is transferred as a driving energy onto the pile. So that energy is used in overcoming the friction, and then the tip starts, once the friction is overcome, the tip starts moving. So the energy applied is given is one, and the work done is another one. If you equate these two, you get the driving resistance, which is the capacity of the pile. That is exactly what we call driving energy. Okay? Next, you go for chisel energy. When a boat pile, what happens? When I have cut the rock, I use a chisel. So when I lift it and put it, then what is going to happen? Its compressive strength is being overrun by the chisel energy that is transferred. Then you go for cutting energy, when you use a boat pile. Right? Like this, various kinds of things are applied into the pile. And then the energy is stored in the system as a capacity. That is how the, all these things come into it. Next. So these are not what we have to call this formula of life. So this is a typical example of a capacity calculation based on your static formula. I have included it just for your reference. Next. Okay. Now, you saw there in the beginning standard penetration principle. Right? You lift a 65-pound hammer, drop it on the wheel, count the number of blows for the 30 centimeters and number of blows is n1. You look at the warehouse expression. The pile raises capacity from the n1. Both are equal. So he takes the capacity, driving capacity based on the energy that is input, that 40 m towards the energy. AP is the area of cross section. And there is a limitation for the Al-Mabir ratio, so that is what it is done in the Mayakov's expression, which we use normally for a driven pile in the design office to get the preliminary assessment of the capacity. Not, that is not the design value. The design value comes after the analysis of the entire pile room using a software. Maybe taxes or maybe any other available theoretical software, and then try to get into the validate this capacity with reference to that, and then use that in your final design. Next. So this is the IDS expression which I asked you just now. Now if you see here, W is the weight of the handle, H is the handle, that should be eta. Maybe I didn't know at that time how to put eta, so I used H. Okay, I'm also somewhere in the ignorant. Okay, now if you take that, W H in eta gives the energy input. S plus C by 2 gives the work done that is by the pile, by the energy that is put in. S is the set into the norm, C is the time when the compression as what is given. To divide one by the other, you get the driving resistance. That is what it gives the capacity of the pile. Next. This is our convenient in our office which we have designed for us to check the capacity of each of the pile. That is the working notes. It is an empirical expression. Next. Now, if I'll show you some of the quantum machinery which we use in this site. Now, what you see here, it is a boat pile machine, right? If you see that the band level is high, that is one of the most sophisticated equipment which we have. It has got a lot of internal facilities, right? It gives the categorality of the pipe as on the model, showing the model afterwards as we go along. Then, as it drills, sensors are there, it gives a drilling resistance, it gives correlated to the shear strength of the soil, and we get the overall profile on that. So, like this, there are a lot of assembly equipments are there, software, and if you link it with a particular email, the computer sends the message to us. For every pile, we collect beautiful data based on it. And that data is what we use sometimes to validate a soil investigation report, compare it with the results, and then try to derive the pile capacities so that our design is more realistic and economical. Right? Next. This is a dual piling data. Where if you see there, there is a hammer that is operating. Next one. This is a radar scan. So this is a casting yard where we have done up to 60 meter jointed piles. For 10 meter segment, 12 meter segments, we try to use it. And then try to joint it by means of the steel joints and then drive it and then try to go over generating the capacity, quite capacity. See, a 400 mm square pile, it is capable of under reasonably ideal soil conditions, it can carry 180 tons. Okay? And the smallest pile, 270 diameter, which we use for smaller jobs, can take up to 70 tons. It is like that. Next. Now what you see on the right side, it is the jointed pipe. Okay? Segments are joined together and then the section is driven. We normally use in this case M40 to M60 grade. So your concrete base design also comes into the picture. Because it should not develop a flat. And now in designing a precast pipe, it is not a capacity alone. Its handling stresses are impacted. Next. When we try this actually, see, this is the way we try to handle the pipe. Now we try to lift it from the shutter, store it, then go to the side, and then lift it for driving, and put it in its position, and then try to drive. So when it is done like this, stresses in the concrete and steel are very, very important. After that, the driving comes into the picture. So the driving resistance also, concrete should not drive. So you have to design this section to resist the driving stresses, handling stresses, and then the capacity of the pipe based on the geological condition. If it is a large group, there is one more thing comes into the picture. The effect of installation on the adjoining pipes and surrounding soil, that also comes into the picture. Like when I am designing a tank, a foundation system for a tank, it has got 300 by 400 pipes of a stretch. Right? Now how to drive it? There is a sequence of driving is involved in a manner that the adjoining piles are not affected and the surrounding soil in the driven pile, already driven pile, should not get disturbed. It should generate the capacity by soil structure interaction. If I disturb the surrounding soil, it will not generate capacity. So we have to be careful with that. So how to drive it, what is the sequence of driving, all these things come into the picture. So there are some standard curves are available to fix your driving stress and handling, so depending on the steel requirement, what type of handling you are doing and so on and so forth. Next. Now, this is a bore piling machine. Right? What you see here, it is what you call that, if you see at the bottom, there is a drilling tool that is attached to that. It generates a hole in the top. And then the hole is retained by a slurry called a cantonite, which is got a thick subtropic effect. I don't know what you are done in the layer of the this is coming into that. Right? How cantonite works is also there. And a considerable amount of research has been done on the effect of insulation, retention of drilling fluid, right, on the development of capacities. A lot of work has been done. Right? So we have to apply a lot of our mind when we design the piling system. Next. This is another mission. See, this HR is a brand name. Okay. Now what is given that 180, if you see that, it is 18 ton meter is the top it generates when it is cutting into the harder strata, but that's a maximum time. That's right. See, this is what I told you. This is the equipment cabin. Right? It is sometimes it is temperature control. The instrument should not be spoiled. Now if you see inside there is a monitor that is given and he is keeping his hand on something. What he is trying to do is check the verticality of the pipe, whether it is vertical. That is number one. Now, whether there is any positional deviation that takes place during drilling, that also includes. Plus, the drilling resistance, right? What is the, see, there is an applied torque, shear strength resists it. So the penetration depend for a particular time, if you have rate of penetration, it is more or less depending upon the soil condition and the drilling time. Okay? So when we try to poke for a piling jar, what we try to do, we make the soil investigation report, study the characteristics, then select the machine that is to be used today, and then try to put it for a planning. So all these things which we have to do in this. Right? Next. There is all the cutting tools which are there, which we use. Okay, next. So now when you are trying to drill the whole thing, as what I told you, the rate of drilling depends upon the shear strength. Now you see this graph, it gives you data for me. Now initially it drills very fast, then the drilling rate slowly reduces, and practically it becomes constant beyond a particular level. It is at that stage we stop the drilling process. Clean the whole thing and then try to put the concrete in the concrete level. Now in all these things, finally, this is a final part of my work, we have a quality control. Okay? See, the quality in pilot, it is number one, generation of the capacity and the way the shaft is treated. So we have to conduct load test as well as what we call integrity test, whether the shaft is perfect or not. Okay, that is what we try to do. Go to the next one. So there are various steps are given here. Next. See, the quality control in pile test should identify the pile tip location, whether the tip has been formed properly or not. That is, whether the tip is getting seated at the correct speed or what we expect. That is the first thing, that has to be checked. The second thing we try to check it is, now in the board one, we collect the sample determination data and we give it for lab testing in the lab. We try to do what's called point load test to get the compressive strength of the rock, match it with what we have assumed in the design, and then try to clear that. Okay, then next what we try to do is back calculate the capacity from the data what we have obtained, cross check. Right, whether the theoretical calculation what you have done in our paper with reference to our software, whether it is right or that has to be done. Then next is the pilot test. Go next. Now, this is exactly what you see is a Lotus arrangement, which is actually as a reaction platform as what we call. Now, this is the arrangement is for 1000 mm. Its capacity is 550 tons. We have to test it for 2.5 tons to load from that. This is around 1,250 tons is what we have to test it. Okay. The reaction which is above 1,400 tons from a concrete plant. Right? Now what is given below that jar which is there, that is 1,500 ton capacity jar, operated electrically. What you see on top is the load transfer plate as what we call. Okay? So then we try to do the test and then from the load settlement curve. Okay, and then from the load settlement curve we try to interpret the results and then try to certify whether the pile is acceptable or not. Okay, next. Yes, sir, you know, but the uplift capacity is the transmission tower when I am designing. When I am designing a pile for a transmission tower, there is a pull-out force. Right? I don't know if you are running a such a transmission tower is designed under two loading conditions. One is a normal cable condition, the second is a cable snapped condition. So when a cable snaps under a high wind, there is a whipping takes place and the tower oscillates. So the entire oscillation is transferred to the plant. Right? So particularly when we design the transmission tower foundation for a high earthquake zone, so we always take another aspect into it. By repeated oscillation, the soil loses its strength. What we call the degradation of shaft friction, that is what we say. We take that also into account in our design. So all these things are there, possible. One thing that you know is software, how to use it, how to model the soil, and how to understand the behavior of the soil foundation system as well. Okay, next. So we get the stresses, and now this is the latest attempt. Now what happens is, see, I do the load test and then the capacity is satisfied. But am I sure whether the pile shaft is perfect? That is the most important requirement for me. Now when I do that, I cannot do X-ray or anything like that. We go for a method, what we call the stress wave propagation. What we try to do is that we give an impact on the pipe. So the stress wave travels over the length of the pipe and then it returns back. So the length, distance traveled by the stress wave is 2 meters, that is one down and one up. And it has got a velocity. Distance traveled by the velocity gives time. So what we try to do is when we give the impact, when we capture the return wave, we find the time at which it returns back. So we try to match it and then get a return wave velocity curve as what we call it. Based on we try to see whether the shaft is curved okay or not. Right? Now, if you see, supposing the shaft, there is a necking or there is a cavity or anything like that, the return wave which is coming up, it gets shattered. You get multiple deflections. Right? Inside the hole something, then side something, then the stiffness variation is something, and the wave will be totally disturbed. So from there we try to find out this is the top. Next. See, this is exactly how what we play the problem. You see the top curve and you see the bottom curve. Now how many axial turns peaks are this one? And whereas now the top, there is one particular deviation, and then the tip, you see the edge of the top, the tip of the pipe, there is a nose, very sharp nose which is absent here. That's where the formation is totally defective in the sitting case. So what we try to do, we mark this pipe, shift it to the, again to the systems lab, and make a profile of the pipe, and see where the problem is. And then try to put it to the load test, and then satisfy, and then try to set it to the pipe, and then accept the bill of that. Next. See, number of such curves are available. See, what is here, if you just see this, how bad it is. So these are all the types of quality tests. Please remember, when you get into the field, nobody will teach you all these things. Yeah? So you have to learn by yourself. Some guidance will be there provided the person you are seeing is a theoretical, and most of them seldom it happens. He is always a quality leader. Okay? So that is why now when you are coming out of the college, you should try to have a reasonable backup of all these things. Okay? Next. See, like this, we have got quite a few examples that are. Now here it is meant for a, see, for example, you saw the reaction platform, how heavy it is. If by chance there is a certain, and the platform tilts, what is going to be the fate? Right? So we, what we try, we don't use a reaction platform for a high capacity plants, like say 800 tons, 900 tons. We are doing now, say about 1200 tons diameter file has got 900 ton capacity. You cannot go on to that type of platform. So we go for what is called a high strength test. By an anchor. Your template is, our reaction platform is done with anchors. So we put that and then try to do the same principle. We try to generate the capacity. Next. So these are the various. Please remember that hammer weight is 1.5% of the pile capacity it has to generate. If it has to generate 600 tons, the hammer weight should be 9 tons. Imagine if I am going to use for capacity of 900 tons into 1,350 tons. I need a 17-ton hammer. And then a crane which has got a capacity of 50 tons. So now what has happened? Because of all these problems, they have changed the testing procedure by what is called a statonomic test, where an explosive is blown and then in that impact the pile gets inside. So based on that we try to derive the capacity. These are the latest developments. Right? So next. So these are the others you. Right. Now you just see there, there are two sensors that are kept in there. And when the hammer falls on top of it, this sensor picks up the return wave and sends it back. Next. Right, next. Now you get a peak like this, that shows the integrity of the curve. And then what is shown here is the tip generation at the bottom. And then this is the low steepen curve. Now you see how that advantage what you get here is when you are doing the reaction platform, you measure the deformation only on the top, not at the tip. Right? You cannot do that. So that includes the concrete compression of the pile material also. Whereas here if you see the head is measured separately, the tip is measured separately. So I get both inputs. And from another I have calibrate the capacity. And then there is what is called, you see the working curve, what is the tons and the test load is 600 tons. So next. See, this is, there are certain things in your, in, when we try to review that certain basic parameters which we check up and then try to certify whether the test is acceptable or not. Next. Okay, now this is what as a broad